Greetings and welcome to Games Made Easy. I'm Dan Z. Today, I play through a solo version of Scythe, Invaders from Afar. This is the expansion to the base game, Scythe. I'm going to assume you already know how to play. If you don't and you would like to learn, go to the master of all board game instructional videos, Rodney Smith's, at Watch It Played. There is also a video out there about just the solo version. I'll link that in the comments below. But I feel that you can really learn the solo version by just watching a playthrough. So join me at the table and watch how it works.
And welcome to the Scythe solo playthrough. I have picked the purple faction and randomly got dealt the industrial player board with it. So we're going to deal with that along with my two objective cards of technological breakthrough, have one factory card and no upgrades, and woodland advantage, control at least three forest territories at the end of your turn. And my starting two combat cards are a 2 and a 3. We will be going up against the green faction and playing on Automa normal mode. For my first action, I'm going to move. Let's take a look at the board. And with this move action, I'm going to move this worker up here to this mountain. I'm going to move my character into the farm right there. And those are my two moves. With no wood to spend, I can't do my bottom action. Let's go to Automa. Taking a look at the first card Automa draws. Again, this top line is what action it takes. And in the parentheses is the green one. So the first thing he wants to do is go to the factory or nearest encounter token. Now the character can only move within the neighborhood of his own units, which would mean all of these four spaces here, or of course the two spaces they're in. But he has not yet learned Riverwalk, so he cannot walk on water yet. Nor, being an expansion faction, can he go onto tunnels. So basically the farthest he can go are these, or the only place he can go are these two areas right there, because he's after these exploration tokens. Both of them are 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3 from the factory, so they're equidistant. So tie-breaking rules say reading direction, so starting top left, going across, the character will go here and explore that token. Also, because he is the expansion faction, every time he goes to a territory not bordering his base, he's going to drop down a flag token. Second portion of the card indicates what he gains this round. He's not playing purple, so we ignore that section. So we just simply go to the fact that he's going to gain a worker. I'm going to put it on his home base. And he's going to gain one coin. Put that on his board. Now, if I would have recruited my guy that gives me a coin, I would gain that now, but I have not. And this star, of course, indicates that he moves one on this track. Our next action is going to be to trade. So I am going to spend one coin and we are going to trade for two metal. Taking these two metal, we're going to go ahead and place them right into the territory with that worker right there who's already going to collect metal anyway. We do not have the food to spend to enlist, so our turn is done. Flipping over the card, let's see what they're going to do. Now, if we were playing on easy mode, that symbol right there would mean we ignore the card completely and just discard it. Since we're in normal, we're going to skip that. He's not playing purple faction, so we skip that. So he wants to move a mech, which he actually does not have any on the board yet, seeing how they're all four still on his faction board. So we move to the next one. He wants to move a worker. When Automa moves worker, he takes the one in his home base or closest to it and then moves it to an area that is in the neighborhood of the most of his own units that doesn't contain one of his own workers. So he can't go here or here. He can go here or in the space that the leader is in. this space, he'd be surrounded by two of his own units, and in that space, he'd also be surrounded by two of his units. So because of the tie, we again go to distance to the factory. And as we saw earlier, it is equidistant to the factory, so we'll go with the reading rules, which means the worker gets placed right there. Going to the second line, he is not playing the red faction, so he doesn't gain two mechs, he only gains one. So one mech will leave, and I'll put them in the home base. No recruitment bonus for me, and we do advance the star one more. We are going to take our pawn and we're going to move it into produce. That does allow this worker to create one metal and this worker to create one oil. We are then going to spend the three metal that was on the mountain space, and we are going to go ahead and deploy a mech. So for those three metal, I'm going to get two coins and deploy a mech. The mech we'll be deploying is the fourth one here. This allows us to move to any territory with a trap token, and I may arm the trap again. So we're going to place this new mech with the worker in the oil in the tundra here. Drawing the next card for Ottoman here, we see the top card is requiring him to move a worker. There is no worker in his home base, so we go to the worker closest to it, and that's both of these. So tiebreaker goes to the reading order, so left to right, this is the chosen worker. Looking at all the possible areas it may go, this is the only valid space because it does not yet have Riverwalk to go on the lakes, and it cannot go on or cross river or on mines yet anyway. So this is the only valid space. It would put it next to two, so it moves to there. Looking at what it gains this round, it looks like it's gaining two power. So moving green up two power puts it at five. No recruitment bonus is made, and the star indicates it does move one more on its card. Our next action is going to be to trade. We're going to go ahead and spend one coin, and we're going to take two metal, and again go ahead and put it with the worker on the mountain. Having no food means we cannot do our enlist action, bottom action, so let's move to the Ottoma. Looking at the Ottoma's card, looks like he's not playing blue, so he doesn't get that action. So it looks like his character wants to go to the factory or an encounter token. His character's there right now. The neighborhood in which he's in is all of this area. He still cannot cross any rivers. So the only valid spot for him to go is that encounter token right there. So that's where he's going, and he's going to take that encounter token away. Because he's on a new space that is not adjacent to his own base, he's going to flag that territory, doubling up its count at the end of the game. He's going to gain one worker and a power, so I'm going to take one worker from his board and place that in his home base. And we're going to give him one power. The recruiting bonus is the power bonus. I do not yet have that. And the star indicates that he may now cross rivers and move on to lakes. For our next action, we're going to move over and we're going to produce again. That places a metal and an oil in those two spaces. We're then going to use the three metal in my mountain space. And we're going to gain two coins and deploy another mech. Here are the two coins. And I'm going to deploy the Ronin. Before combat, where you have exactly one unit, gain two power. And we're going to deploy that mech in this mountain area right there. Let's look to see what Autumn is going to do this round. Again, if it was easy mode, I would skip the card entirely. But instead, he wants to move a worker. He does have a worker in his home base, so that is the one that I will pick up. Looking for areas that are adjacent or in the neighborhood of the most of his units, and he now can be on lakes and cross rivers. This space right here is surrounded by 1, 2, 3, 4 units. So that is the space that is surrounded by most of his units, and that's where it'll be placed. If he was yellow, he would gain a coin and a combat card, but being only that he's green here, he only gains his one combat card. If we had recruited the guy that gives us a combat card, we would gain that now, but we have not, and this indicates he does not move that cube this round. For our turn, we're going to go back to the trade action. We're going to go and spend one coin, and we are going to again grab two metal, and we're going to continue to just put the metal in the mountain area with that worker. Still with no food, we don't get to enlist. Autumn looks like he wants to move a worker again. Now, Autumn does not have any workers in his home base, so we use the worker that's closest to it, and that would be him right there. We look around in the area in his neighborhood, and he's actually sitting in a space close to 1, 2, 3, 4. Out here, this is next to 1, next to 2, next to 1, next to 3, next to 2, next to 2, and next to 3. So his spot is the best spot, so that worker will not move. Autumn is going to gain 3 power this round, bringing him up to a total of 9. There is no recruitment bonus, and the star indicates we do move the cube one more space. For our action this round, we are going to produce. So we are going to take 1 oil and 1 metal and produce them in their respective hexes. We're then going to take the 3 metal on the mountain space, grab us 2 coins, and deploy another mech. Here we are with 2 coins, and we're going to go ahead and go with the one where it allows me to move into and from lakes, and if I fight in a lake, I get to use an additional combat card. And we're going to deploy this mech into the mountain. Taking a look what Autumn will do this round. All right, if he was black, he would be attacking, but he's not black, so he's going to move on to moving his character to the factory or an encounter point. Now, Autumn can only move his character when they're in the neighborhood of his existing units, and you'll notice that that only allows him to go about this far. There are no encounter tokens or factories, for that matter, in that area, so he cannot perform the encounter factory action. So skipping that action too makes us go to this third one, or means now it says move the character as you would a normal mech. When moving like a mech, the mech wants to get as close to your units as possible. So you'll notice that I'm way over here. So he's going to pick any of these hexes that are as closest to me, and as a tiebreaker, get as close to the factory as he can. So with all that in a consideration, he's going to move his character to right there, right adjacent to the factory. This round says that he's going to gain 1 coin, so we're going to give him that. No recruitment bonus, and the star indicates we do move the cube another space on the card. Our action this round is going to be to bolster. We're going to go ahead and pay 1 of our coins to move up 2 power. We're then going to use the 3 oil that is accumulated on our tundra space, and we are going to upgrade. So we're going to gain 3 coins and an upgrade. The upgrade we're going to take is we're going to actually take the movement cube, and we're going to make upgrading cheaper. Flipping over the next card for Autumn, looks like he wants to move a mech. Moving a mech, he always wants to move a mech that's in his home base first, and there is one there, so he's going to move that. And he's going to move it, as we mentioned earlier, closest to me as possible, with the tiebreaker being closest to the factory, which in this case is the factory itself. Autumn of this round will be gaining a mech or character. His character is still alive, so he's going to gain a mech, which puts it on his home base, and he's going to gain 2 power, bringing him up to 11. There is no recruitment bonus, and the star indicates we move the cube. This round, we're going to go ahead and use our newly upgraded move action and gain ourselves 3 guys moving. Now, the 3 guys I'd like to move is I'm going to move this mech into this village, and I'm going to have him take the worker with him. I'm going to move this mech from the tundra into the mountain, also taking this worker with him. And I'm going to have the character also move into the mountain and see what he encounters in that space. Looks like we've come across sort of, some soldiers on a, looks like a broken mech and a bear and such. I can take photos for the overly enthusiastic soldiers, gain 2 metal and a popularity. I can hire a mercenary to join your group. Pay 3 to enlist a recruit or practice your shooting at the unsuspecting targets. Pay 2 popularity and gain 4 metal. Well, we almost have all of our mechs on the board. I'm not too worried about the metal. I think I'm going to go ahead and pay 3 to enlist a recruit. So here's my 3 coins, and I'm going to bring in the one under the bolster and upgrade category. That way, every time we upgrade, we will also gain a power. And of course, when Automa now allows me to gain power, I will. And with this new recruit, I'm going to go ahead and gain 2 power right now, bringing me up to 4. And with no wood, I cannot build a building. So no bottom action. Let's move to Automa. Automa's next card tells us that it would skip this card if we weren't playing on normal. It wants to attack. If it has a strength of power of at least 6, it would attack us. However, you will notice that we have no units in his neighborhood or in any space adjacent to his mechs. So he has no targets to attack. So instead of attacking one of our combat units, he says, okay, fine, I'll attack one of your workers that are left alone in field. Well, he can't reach any of those either, so he moves the last one here. He's going to move one of his workers. Now, he has no workers in his home base, so we pick the closest one to it, and that's that guy right there. Looking around at all the spaces, he's currently surrounded by 3. He could also get surrounded by 3 right here, and that technically is closer to the factory, so he's going to move right to there. The card instructs us that he's going to gain 2 coins this round, so we'll give him 2 coins. Then recruitment gains a power. Hey, I just opened that one up. So I go to 5. And lastly, the cube does not move since that star is not visible. My action this round is going to be to trade. I am going to go ahead and pay 1 coin and get ourselves 2 metal once again, placing it with one of my workers on the board. With no food to spend, we cannot enlist, so let's head over to Automa. Flipping over Automa's card, again, this would be skipped if it was easy mode. And if he was playing black, he'd be attacking again. But it looks like instead he's going to move a worker. With no workers in his home base, he's going to choose the worker closest to it. There's 2 of them actually at the same distance, 2 away. So in reading order, that means this worker is the one that's going to be chosen. And he's currently in a space surrounded by only 1 guy. He could go here for 3, he could go here for 3, but he could also go to the factory itself and also be surrounded by 1, 2, and 3 units. And again, tiebreakers always go to the factory. So he is going to move to there. And while doing this, I actually noticed that the character is in a space away from the home base without a token. So I'm going to go ahead and put that in there. That was supposed to be done when he moved in there several rounds back. According to the card, Automa wants to gain a worker and a coin. So I'm going to take a worker off the board and put it up in his home base and give him a coin. The recruitment bonus is popularity. I do not have that one unlocked yet, so I do not gain that. But that star means he moves 1 away from going to his second half of his cards. This round, we're going to produce. With this worker on a village, we're going to gain another worker, placing 2 in there now. And with that worker on a mountain, we're going to gain a medal. And we're going to spend the 3 metal that are in our territories to go ahead and gain 2 coins and deploy our final mech. Taking the mech off our board, placing it into this village space. And with that, we get our first star of all 4 mechs in the game. Looking at what Autumn would like to do this round, it is not blue, so it won't move a worker, but instead it will move a mech. It always wants to move a mech that's in its home base, so we'll take this one from its home base. And again, it always wants to be as close to me as it can, while with the tiebreaker being closest to the factory. So both of these spaces, here and here, are two away from these units right there. So both of those are two, so those a tiebreaker would be reading direction, so top line left to right. That is where that mech is going to stay. Looks like Automa's rearing up for an attack, for it's gaining 4 combat this round, bringing it up to 15. There is no recruitment bonus, and the star means that Automa has earned its first star and is now entered age 2. This round we're gonna moving 3 units. Taking a look at our situation, I think the best we're going to do is we're going to move this mech into this village, bringing this worker with it. We're going to move the character behind that, and with that character, we're going to go ahead and drop our -4 coins trap into that zone right here. So if we get attacked, Autumn is going to lose 4 points. We like that. And lastly, we're going to move this mech down here. We're going to move it up into that forest area right there. And that will be it. Those are our 3 moves. And still with no wood, we cannot build a structure. So let's move over to Autumn. The Autumn deck has been combined and shuffled. It's been flipped over, so now 2 is on top. And we will now start reading the red section of the cards now that we're in the second half. And it looks like he wants to move a mech. Now there is no mech in his home base, so that would mean we have to choose the one that is closest to it. 1, 2, 3, 4, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that one's 5 away, but this one's only 4 away. So this is the mech that we're moving. And again, it wants to be as close to us as possible. And so it's just gonna simply move forward 1 space. This space would also be 1 away, but this is 2 away from the factory. This is only 1 away from the factory, so that wins the tiebreaker. So that's where he's at. Autumn is also gaining 2 coins and building a mech. So I'm going to take a mech off his player board and put it on his home base. No recruitment bonus, and the cube does move. Oh, I would really like to move this round, maybe get an attack in on that one that just moved into the ocean, because we got our additional card for that. But we're already on move, so let's move it over to produce and continue my plan of now with 3 workers on village spaces. We're going to take all 3 of these workers, and 2 are going to join this guy, and 1's going to join him up top. We do not have 3 metal in order to gain 2 coins, so we move on to Autumn. Autumn flips the card, and if they were playing the black faction, then they would be attacking. But instead, they're just going to move another mech. Now, he does have a mech in home base, so we're going to go ahead and just take that one. And let's see. Looks like to be adjacent to us or closest to one of our combat units, it can go here. Or it can go here, both of which would be 1 away from our units. This space is 2 away from the factory, and that space is 2 away from the factory, so both of them are equal distance from the factory, which means in reading order, left to right, top to bottom, that is where that mech is going to lie. If he was red, he'd be getting 2 mechs this round, but he's only going to get his 1 mech, his final mech, onto the board. And he gains another combat card, which we'll secretly place there, putting him up to a total of 2. Recruitment bonus is a coin, and I don't have that unlocked, so I will not gain a coin. But he will move his box forward 1 onto the next round. I think this is going to be an exciting round because we are going to move, and I think we're going to battle. Let's take a look. Our first move is going to be to move the leader to here using the tunnel, and after they move, they're going to go ahead and drop the -2 combat card trap right into that zone. Now, because there's a trap there, I can now use my special movement to move this mech to here, taking all 4 workers with it. That's number 2. And my third is going to move this mech across the river, because we can move across one river one time with one mech or character. And we're going to battle this mech up there, mostly because the Automa card currently on top shows two resources, which means if I can win this battle, two oil resources will be placed into this territory, and I'll have those two oil resources to use. This does temporarily leave these two workers vulnerable. I'm hoping later maybe to move these guys in, but I do have the trap there. So if they do take the workers, at least they'll suffer the four coin trap that is located right there. Let's take a look at this battle. Before we start, let's remember, before combat, where I have exactly one unit, gain two power. That two power gain puts me up to the maximum of seven. Now I plan on producing soon, so I want to keep at least one power for that. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to spend six power, and we're definitely going to use my one card there for three, so our total is going to be a nine. When Automa enters combat, you draw the top card of the Automa deck, flip it over, but you're only going to look at this bottom portion right over here. Depending on its current power, it's going to spend this amount of power in the battle. Being at 15, it's at 14 plus, so it's going to spend 7 of its power. And it's going to use one of its power cards, or combat cards. It had two to use, so I'm going to just flip over that one. And so the 7 plus the 3 is 10, which unfortunately beats my 9. So Automa wins the battle. My mech returns home. Automa does gain one star for winning a combat. And we gain the top combat card for Constellation here, and we get 3. With no wood to spend, we can't build a building, so on to Automa's turn. Now you will note that the cards used for combat are discarded in a separate location than the cards used for his turn. This is mostly because then to be able to look back, if you need to, for example, remember how many spaces the cube has passed the current age, you can just count up the stars in there. The other reason is that this resource is, again, the top card of the discard pile marks how many resources are in the spaces Automas are in. So, for example, discarding this on top would change that to a 4, and that's just not how it's designed. So discard those in a separate pile, but let's go ahead and see what he is doing this round. He would, if we're on the easy mode, skip discard, but instead he is going to move a worker. Automa does have a worker in his base, so we're going to take that, and we're going to place it again in the area with the most of his units in and around his space. So putting it here, for example, would put it around 1, 2, 3, 4 units. Putting it here also puts it around 4 units as well, and not adjacent to any of my combat unit. It puts it against my workers, but it can't be adjacent to any of my combat units. So this space and this space are both legal, or the most favored spaces with 4 units adjacent to them, both of which are one space away from the factory. So tiebreaker means reading direction means top left to bottom right. There we go. The worker goes in the water. If it was playing yellow, it would be getting 3 coins this round. Instead, it is only gaining 2. And I gain a power because I do have that recruiter. It does not move its cube. This round, we are going to produce. With all the workers now on the field, you see I have to spend both a power and a popularity to produce. So power drops by 1. My popularity drops by 1, and now I'm able to produce. This hex of 4 workers will produce 4 oil, and that hex of 2 workers in a village will produce 2 more workers, bringing my total up to 4, and as you can see, I now have 8 workers on the board, so I get a star for 8 workers. I do not have the metal required to deploy a mech. I don't have the mechs, but I could get the 2 gold. Don't have the metal anyway. Let's move to Autumna. Alright, Autumna. If it was blue, it would be moving a worker, but instead it's going to move a mech. Autumna does have a worker in his home base, and the space closest to my units would be here, because it's also closest to the factory. So we are going to move that that mech to right there. It's one away from the factory and one away from my units. Autumna is going to gain a combat card, bringing him up to a total of 2. He's going to gain 1 single coin, and he's going to put a mech on the board if he had one, but he does not. And due to the recruiter bonus, I get a power, bringing me up to 2. And with a star, he moves his cube down to the next level. This round, we're going to get those workers protected by activating our move. We get to move 3 units. First and foremost, we're going to move this mech up to protect those 4 workers in the village. Second, we're going to move our character out of that tundra and into this village because there's an encounter. And third, we're going to take the mech from our home base using our special ability of going to any trap. We're going to bring him over here to help protect our oil resource over there. Let's see what we've encountered. Looks like we've come across the 2 different type of bears kind of meeting each other out in the wilderness here. The bears can frolic together in the snow. We gain 2 money and 1 popularity. Start a bear cavalry by enlisting the animal. Pay 3 and enlist 1 recruit. Or have a bear meat sandwich for lunch. Pay 2 popularity to gain 4 food. I think we're due for another enlist, honestly. So we're going to go ahead and pay 3 to enlist 1 recruit. So we're going to pay 3 coins. And we're going to recruit this recruit here. So my popularity will start growing when it shows up on the card for Autumna. And while we're at it, we're going to go ahead and take 2 popularity right now to help us out. With no wood to spend, we can't do a build action, so let's move on to Autumna. Flipping over the card here. If they were playing black, they would be attacking, but instead it looks like the character wants to either go to the factory or go to an encounter token. Because green has not yet gotten a factory card, that does mean if it's available, that's its first choice, and that's exactly what it does. It moves into the factory. And because it does have a token left over, it is going to actually claim the factory as a +1 territory flag right there. It's also going to receive the top factory card from the deck, kept face down, preventing us from using that if we ever get to the factory ourselves. This round, the card says it gains a combat card, which we will give it now, putting its total up to 3 and 2 coins. If our recruit for coin was open, we would gain a coin right now. We do not, but the cube does move forward, putting it ever so closer to another star earned. It is time to bolster. We're going to take our pawn, move it over to the bolster action. We're going to pay 1 coin to go up 2 power, moving us from 2 to 4. But we're also going to spend 2 oil from the board here. And that allows us to gain another power, 3 coins, and we get to upgrade. And we're going to go ahead and upgrade. We're going to take the, we're going to now have bolster give us 3 power. At the same time, we're going to reduce the cost of, I think we're going to reduce the cost of building a building to only 2 wood instead of 3. Autumna now flips its card and here it comes. If its power is up at least 8, it wants to attack. And as you can see, it is exactly 8, so that's exactly what it's going to do. Now that we've confirmed that he does have 8 power, he takes any combat unit, the one closest to the base, and attacks with it. The combat unit he has closest to the base is actually his character, the one that's standing in the factory. It's only 4 spaces away from his base, where these mechs are 5 and this one is 6. So his character is going to attack. He attacks, any combat unit in the neighborhood of his units, which are all four spaces of my mechs, he wants to attack the hex or the space with the least amount of combat units, so he will not attack this one with two, but he could attack one, two, or three. The tiebreaker is distance from the factory, and so there's the factory there. They're all two spaces away. An additional tiebreaker is, because I'm playing purple, is the additional tiebreaker is he would rather disarm a trap if he could. So this is actually going to be the winning sector. So he's going to move into here, and we're going to fight. But before the fight, he does act, or he does trigger the trap, which means he's losing four coins. Now, you may recall that I have before combat where you have exactly one unit gain two power. Be aware that workers count for this. So I don't have one unit there. I have five. So I do not get this two power. And I'm going to tell you the truth that I don't mind losing this battle. These are not in really a great position. I don't need villages anymore. And I would rather him spend his power so maybe I can counterattack later. So I'm actually going to submit zero power and no cards. And I'm going to go in the battle with zero. Let's see what he does. Because he's got 8 power, we're going to use the center number, 8 to 13, which means he's going to spend 7 of this 8 power. And according to this, he's also going to spend 1 of his 3 combat cards. And he just spent a 5. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Our mech and 4 workers retreat back into our home base. Be aware that the Automa never loses popularity. He always stays at 10, regardless of what happens with that. I gain my extra combat card for losing the battle. I now have another 3. But most importantly, I have more power than he does. He's quite weakened. We might be able to do a lot of counterattacking now. But let's not forget, Green does gain his second star for winning a combat. But any more combats are not going to be beneficial to him. If he was yellow, he'd be gaining 2 coins in a worker. Instead, he's only going to gain 1 coin in a worker. So I'm going to take this worker, put it into his home base, and give him a coin. And due to recruitment bonus, I get a popularity up to 4. And the cube will not move this round. This round, we're going to go ahead and move, setting us up for my next stage of production here. Our first movement is going to be the character is going to shift out here to this village and encounter that token. The other thing he's going to do is he's going to drop the minus 2 popularity token here. Really, only hopefully that it never gets used, because this actually is useless. Automa cannot lose popularity, so this is a useless trap. What I'm hoping is that I just keep control of this sector at the end of the game. So that's one. My second movement is going to move this whole band to this trap token. Again, moving the mech there, and the mech carries the workers there. So we got all this big party inside that, or on the mountain there. But three is going to move a different mech to this wooded area and take 4 workers with him. So he's going to do that. So now we got some people in the forest. We're going to start building some buildings, I think, and get some structures built. Plus, that gives me popularity for building them. Let us now go ahead and see what we've encountered. As I'm walking through the village, apparently I run into this underground facility. I can gain 2 power and 1 popularity by salvaging some ammo. I can bribe the researchers to give me an advanced weapon, pay 2 to gain 4 power, or I can spy on the research secrets after pretending to befriend them. I definitely think I'll be bribing them this time. The 4 power will be perfect for this time. So we are going to go ahead and bribe those researchers, pay 2 for 4 power. And that 4 power brings us up to 9. Now, we don't yet have wood to spend, but we will soon to be able to build a structure. Moving over to Automa, let's see what he's doing this round. If he was playing white, he'd be looking for the factory or an encounter token. But instead, he's going to move a mech. There is no mech in his home base, so we must find the mech that's closest to it. all of these are five spaces away. So we have to go with reading order, which would mean top, up left, all across. This is the first mech in that order. So this is the mech that's going to be moving. And again, it wants to be as closest to our units as possible. So it could go here, it could go there, it could go there, and anyway around my character here, I guess. But this is going to be ultimately the place it lands, because this space is too far from the factory, being three spaces away. These two spaces are only two from the factory, and thus in reading order, that one comes before that one. Trying to get its power back, it's going to gain three power and a worker. So I'm going to take a worker off its board, placing it up in his home base. I'm going to raise his power up to four. I do have the popularity recruiter hired, so I am going to move my popularity up to five and move the cube one space, which means he gains another star. So we'll take one star and put it on the next base on the track. He's up to four. With our workers in place, we are going to produce. And with all the workers already on the board, I'm paying a power, a popularity, and a coin. So here's the coin. Power drops from 9 to 8. And popularity drops from 5 to 4. In our squares, though, or in our territories, we're going to get 4 wood in that territory. And we're going to get 4 oil in this one. Now, we do not have any metal at the currently, so we don't get 2 coins for turning that in. Let's see what Autumn is going to do about this. Flipping over the card. It's not blue, so it won't move a worker. Instead, the character is actually going to look for he's already got a factory card, so right up there. So it looks like he's got to find an encounter token in his range. So looking at the board, he's got this encounter token that is adjacent to one of his people, as is this one. Both of which are 2 spaces away from the factory, so they are equidistant. And so in reading order, the character is going to move back to this mountain and encounter this token. For the second round in a row, he's going to gain 3 power and a worker. That puts his final worker onto the board and moves his power up to 7. The recruiting bonus is a combat card, which I do not have. And that star means this cube is moving over to that space right there. Another hefty turn we're going to take with the movement. Let's move 3 units. Our first movement's going to be across the river right there. Our character's going to go into that forest right there. Our second movement is this mech right here is going to take the tunnel all the way over to this piece of forest over there. And lastly, we're going to take this mech right here and charge forward into the ocean, into the lake, because we can actually enter the lake, and actually we get a bonus for doing so. So let's resolve this combat. First off, before the combat, realize that we do have exactly 1 unit in the battle, so we're going to gain 2 power from that. And a combat on lakes, I get an extra card. So with the 2 bonus, that puts me up to 10 power, and I get to use 2 of these cards. I'm thinking we're going to go ahead and use the, lowest one with its additional to that, making it 5. And I think we're going to add another 5 to it. So I think we're going to go with it to double digits. We're going to go with a flat out 10 on this attack. Looking at the card drawn, it looks like if he is at 7, he wants to spend 3 of it. So he's going to go down to 4, and he's not going to use any of his combat cards, which means that is his total. So I've won the battle. When you win a battle against one of his mechs, that mech goes back to his player board, not to his home base. Us moving into here gives us a combat star. And with the loss, he does gain a random combat card for next time. And with the movement round complete, you'll notice that I have a 1, a 2, a 3 forest controlled, which brings us woodland advantage. Control at least 3 forest territories at the end of your turn. So we're going to gain an additional star this round, this time in the achievement category. In addition, we finally have some wood to spend. So we are going to spend 2 of these wood in one of our forests. We're going to gain a popularity for that, a coin, and a building. Our popularity raises to 5. The coin gives us 4. And because of the building bonus this game, being that they want to put buildings on either tundras or farms, we're going to build a monument on our favorite territory, this tundra right there. Let's take a look what Arma's going to do about this. All right, he wants to send his leader to find yet another encounter token. There is, in fact, only one place for him to go. He's going to move from here to here and explore that token. With that complete, he is the green player, so he actually gets a mech, a worker, and 2 coins. Now, he has no more workers. They're all on the board, but this mech can now be rebuilt and put onto the board. And, of course, he gets his 2 coins. I get no recruitment bonus, and the cube does move 1 more space. 1 more before his next star. This round, we're going to go ahead and use our upgraded bolster. So we are going to pay 1 coin to go up 3 power and a popularity. So 3 power takes us up to 8. 1 popularity takes us up to 6. And now we spend 2 of those oils in our favorite tundra space. We gain ourselves 3 coins, another power, bringing us up to 9. And of course, an upgrade. And we're going to take this second coin for doing the move or gain action. And we're going to come down here and reduce the cost of our mechs to 2 metal. Autumn flips over. Ooh, he's coming. No, he's not coming after us. I thought he was. If you take a look right there, if he had the power of 7, he would take a combat unit to attack. But he is currently only sitting at a power of 4, so he will ignore this action. Moving on to the next action means if he can't attack with a combat unit, he'll attack then any worker that is not defended. So if any worker is off by themselves, he will then take over that space. As you can see, and as you know, all my workers are properly defended with mechs, so he will also ignore that order. Leaving him with the final action to take is to just move a mech. He has a mech he just rebuilt in his home base, so that's the one that will move. And it wants to, again, be as close to my units as possible. So this space right here is 1 away from my space. And using the tiebreaker of closest to factory, it is the factory. So it is going to move right there. Trying to recover some of its power. It's going to gain 3 power this round, taking its total up to 7. And the recruitment bonus is popularity, which I do have. So we are going to cross into tier 2 of popularity up to 7. With the star shown on the card, the cube does move. It goes on top of the star, which means it does gain its 5th star. All right, a big round here because we are going to go back to the move command here. We got to move 3 units, and we have an important battle to win. Our first movement will be our character out into this area for that encounter. Our second movement is just going to be 1 worker to head into this farm right here. And our third is going to be this unit moving in on the factory. Now, this is going to be our big battle here because currently this is 4 territories for our opponent. This will reduce him down to 0 and us, of course, up to 3. We will lose a popularity because of the worker there, but I plan on gaining that popularity back by building the building here. And again, buildings in farms and tundras get extra coins. So this battle is going to be crucial in order to win this. Let's see what happens. Let's remember, before combat, when you have exactly 1 unit, I do gain 2 power. So rather than starting with 9, I will be starting at 11. But I am immediately going to spend 7 of this because I need everything I can get on this. And I will, of course, spend my only combat card of 3 to make our total 10. Let's hope this is enough. Our opponent has 3 combat cards, and this is the top of the deck. Being at 7 power, he's going to use this category, which means he's going to spend all 7, but he's not going to spend any combat cards. So our risk paid off. We got 10, they got 7. We won the battle. Having won the battle, this mech will return to his player board, but this worker will return to his home base. We will lose 1 popularity for sending that worker back, but more importantly, we now own the territory with the factory. He gains a card for his loss, and we gain a star for our win. Being the end of movement, we now have a character card on an encounter token, so we're going to remove the token and see what encounter we come across. It appears while walking through this forest, we've come across this, looks like farm with a bunch of pigs and such. We can help repair a broken fence to secure the pigs, gain 2 food and a popularity. We can disassemble the mech for spare parts, pay 2 for any 3 resources. Or we can startle the pigs to start a stampede, pay 2 popularity, and gain 1 worker and 3 metal. Well, we really want that popularity right now to put us back into the second tier. So that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to gain 2 food and 1 popularity, bringing us up to 7, and 2 food going in that space. As well as that, we are also going to drop our final trap token, -3 combat, into this space. Because I do plan on leaving this space, but it will still be technically my space or under my control as long as that trap token remains armed. With all the movement done, we can now spend the 2 wood that was sitting in our field in order to gain a popularity, a coin, and a building. Popularity is at 8. 1 coin brings us to 10. And we are going to build the mill in this farm location right there. Seeing what Automa is going to do this round, looks like it just wants to move a mech. Automa does not have any mechs in his home base, so looking at the closest mechs to it are these both at 5 spaces away. Looking at reading order, that would mean this is the closest mech, so this is the one that we're going to see where it's going to move. Again, it always wants to be closest to our units while also trying to stay close to the factory. So being right around this guy, all these spaces are 1 away from him. And using the tiebreaker of closest, I guess now reading order, because they're all close to the factory, it would have to be this space right here that the mech enters. If Automa was yellow, it'd be gaining a coin, 2 power, and a mech. As it stands, it's just going to be 2 power, and he's going to rebuild this mech that he lost. Trying to rebuild his army from his recent defeat. With the recruitment bonus, I too gain a power, taking me up to 5. And it does raise its cube up 1 more level. And with 5 stars already up there, next round could be the last. What could very well be our final round. I want to get as many points as I can. I would love to move, honestly, maybe spread out a little bit, grab some territories, but we can't do so because we did so last round. So we are going to instead go over here to bolster. We are going to go ahead and pay 1 coin in order to take a combat card. I don't want the 3 power. We're already above them in power. I want the combat card. We're going to take the combat card. And of course, the popularity. The combat card we're gaining is a 2. Been pretty unlucky with those this game. The increase in popularity does take us up to 9. But the main feature of the round is the fact that we are going to spend 2 of our oil to gain another combat point, bringing us up to 6. but more importantly, three coins and an upgrade. And we're going to go ahead and allow ourselves to get two combat cards for the bolster action while also making our recruitment a little bit cheaper. Let's see if Autumn is going to be ending the game. It will be. All right, taking a look at its action, it wants to move a worker. Autumn currently has four workers sitting in his home base, so one of those will definitely be doing this movement. And looking on the board, again, workers want to be surrounded by as many of their units as possible without being in one space movement from my combat units. So the best spot to actually go with one of his workers is this spot right there, because it surrounds him by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of his own units, and it is not one step from any of mine. Again, trying to build up his army from my recent defeat of him, he wants 4 power back. This temporarily brings him up with part of me at 6, but I will be going to 7 because of my recruit bonus on the card. But none of that is relevant because of the fact that with that star right there, the cube moves on to the final, to a star space, which means his final star goes on the board. The game is over. Let's go to final scoring. Looking at final scoring, Autumn always has 10 populations, so he's always using these tier 2 scoring. This, by the way, is a great way of adjusting the difficulty of Autumn. You can make him start with 5 for an easier game or 15 for a tougher game. I actually beat him once when he was at 15 on the normal mode. I was very excited. But let's see if did I do that today. But he is on 10, so we're going to do 4 coins for all his stars. And of course, he was the one to complete the game with 6 stars. So that's going to give him 24 coins. He's also going to get 3 coins for every single territory he owns. Looking over the map here, he has got zone 1 with a flag on it. So that's 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Those are his only 10 zones. Me taking over this factory was huge because that would have been a 14, and that's a 12-point swing. So as it is, he is only getting 30 coins from his territories. So he ended the game already with 16 coins, adding the 24 from the stars and the 30 from the territories. Autumn has actually ended the game with exactly 70 coins. Let's see how we fared. We too are in tier 2 point scale, so we are going to get 4 coins for every star up there, and we have 5 stars up there for a total of 20 coins. We're going to get 3 coins for every territory we control. At 3 coins per territory, I control 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. There's nobody here, but my armed trap token does control this zone. This zone, as you can see, though, has a trap token, but it's not armed, so I do not control that one. So this is a total of 9 territories. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Being in tier 2 means I get 2 points per pair of resources I've left over. I do have 4 resources left over for a total of 4 coins additionally. Lastly, the building bonus here is I do have 2 buildings built on farm or tundra. The mill being on our farm and our monument being on the tundra. So that's another 4 coins. So ending the game with the 9 coins I have plus the 20 from the stars plus the 27 from my territories. 4 more from my resources and 4 more from my buildings gives me a total of 64. Autumn wins by 6 points.